for your dedication.
Thanks for running, everybody. The Church of Jesus Christ is alive and well. Don't tell me the church is going down, please. It's going up. I'm glad to be a part of that going up. Amen. Thank you so much for the honor of speaking and our friends and our wonderful pastor here and church here. My wife and I, you may be seated. We have quite an affinity with this church. It began back in the days of Pastor MacFarlane. He had a death in his family, lost his daughter, and we happened to be here right after that and preached a revival, and we bonded. Amen. And we still feel that bond, and thank you for the honor of saying something for celebration of 1/10 of 1 century relationship between Brother and Sister Rhodes and this church. We're giving honor to the Rhodes, but we also need to give honor to this church, because it takes saints of God to a strong church. See, I call him my presbyter. He served Section 11 for 13 years and was pastor of this church interim time. And we love Brother Trammell and Sister Trammell. Give them a Now, I don't know what you're expecting out of me, but I was told to preach a little bit. Amen. I want to speak to you tonight for a few minutes about spiritual priorities. Spiritual priorities will make a church great. President Trump says, let's make America great again, and I'm for that. But my message tonight is, let's make the Church of Jesus Christ great again. Message tonight, and it's intended for all of God's people, including pastors, preachers, and it's simply, unless our priorities are in line, our life and our ministry will get out of line. So it's real urgent, folks, that we establish some spiritual priorities and then adhere to those principles.
Yes, right.
I want to present 7 of them, and I know I've got a limited amount of time, but the first one, the number one priority, is to love God with all your heart. Amen. And the reason I mention love God with all your heart as the first one is because Jesus listed it as being the first priority. When he said, thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, all thy soul, and all thy mind, this is the first. Everybody say, first. And great commandment. I want to love Jesus more than I love any person or anything on the face of this earth. There's no higher commandment on God's priority list than for his disciples to love him. We're not to exalt our leadership or our talents or our abilities, but we are to exalt God Almighty, because he is the giver of every good and perfect gift. Can I get a witness tonight? We should love God with all our heart, mind, and soul. We will never sin the sin of idolatry. Idolatry is a no-no. It's a taboo. We don't want to sin the sin of idolatry, and we don't want to love anything or anyone in our lives Amen. More than we love our God Amen. Of heaven. Hallelujah. Amen. Do I think about and do I spend more time with the Dallas Cowboys and the New Orleans Saints or my hunting and fishing hobbies or any person or anything that I do with my God? That's the question tonight. The first commandment should be our first priority of our life. Love God with all of our heart, mind, and soul. I think I'm preaching to some people that believe what I'm saying tonight. Priority number two, next things. We should please God. We should emulate our Master Jesus and His relationship with His Heavenly Father. He said in John chapter 8, He that sent me is with me. The Father hath not left me alone. And I do always those things that pleased Him. Yes. I want that kind of testimony for my life. I want to be like Jesus. And I want to please God and do always the things that please Him.
Amen.
I think we should also emulate Enoch's relationship that he had with God.
Yeah.
Enoch walked with God and he left a great testimony. We find the record of it in the book of Hebrews. Uh-huh. By faith, Enoch was translated that he should not see death, and was not found because God had translated him. For before his translation, he had this testimony that he pleased God. The Bible tells us that Enoch did not begin his relationship with God until he was 65 years old. And then for 300 years thereafter, he walked with God and he pleased him in that relationship. Listen to me. God pleasers are, they're supremely blessed of God. The book of Proverbs says, when a man's ways please the Lord, he maketh even his enemies to be at peace with him. I want to please God in every way. And I'm determined that I'm going to find out and I'm going to know what God's will and God's word has to say so I can obey it and please Him in all things. Come on, clap your hands to the Lord. Enoch pleased the Lord, and as a result, he was supernaturally caught up to meet the Lord in the air. And if you and I will please the Lord, we too will be caught up to meet the Lord. For we, which are alive and remember, shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And so shall we ever be with the Lord. We will establish these priorities. We'll have revival.
Yes, sir.
Amen. I'm in a church that has practiced these.
Yeah.
Pastor and saints alike. Yes. Priority number three is to know God.
Yes.
I don't want to just know about God.
That's right.
But I want to know God and have a personal day-by-day walk with Him. I want to walk with Him. I want to talk with Him. I want to meditate on His words. Hallelujah. And why do I want to know God? Daniel answers this question. The people that do know their God shall be strong and do exploits. Hallelujah. Listen to me briefly here. We can be a preaching machine and still not really know God. With flowery words, but not really know the Lord. We can memorize the Bible and not really know the author of the Bible. We can be faithful in our church attendance, in our tithes and offering, and still not really know God. We can say beautiful prayers and really not know God. Amen. The Apostle Paul cried out and he said, even though I have ascended to the third heaven and I communicated directly with God, still the daily cry of my heart, he said, is to know Him better. This is the way he said it in Philippians chapter 3. I counted loss for Christ those things which were gain. Doubtless I counted all things but loss for the excellency of the knowledge of Christ Jesus my Lord, for whom I have suffered the loss of all things. Do count them but dung that I may win Christ and be found in Him, not having my own righteousness which is of the law, but that which is through the faith of Christ, the righteousness which is of God by faith, that I may know Him. That I may know Him and the power of His resurrection, and also know the fellowship of His sufferings, being made conformable unto His death, if by any means I might attain unto the resurrection of the dead.
Amen.
I want to experience that kind of experience that Paul had and know Jesus better.
Yeah.
I want to walk with Him every day.
Yeah.
And if I do, I'll be in a state of continual revival.
Yeah.
And if a bunch of people in the church will get in that frame and attitude, you can't stop the miracles. You can't stop the signs and the wonders. Tonight is simply to obey God. Somebody say, I've got to obey God. Jesus said, if you love me, keep my commandments. It's easy for us to get up here and sing songs about, oh, how I love Jesus. But it's the adherence to the Word of God that proves our love. Jesus, our supreme example, learned obedience by the things that He suffered. And we, the followers of Jesus, will be students in God's school of learning for the rest of our life. Amen. Jesus, being found in fashion as a man, humbled Himself and became obedient unto death, even the death of the cross. And if we believers will take up our cross and follow Him as we obey Him by denying ourselves, we will be in revival mode and there will be wonderful things accomplished in the Holy Ghost. It's important to be obedient. To be obedient. King Saul learned a very hard lesson about disobedience. God gave him a specific command to utterly destroy the Amalekites and their spoils. Well, Saul partially obeyed that command. He did destroy the Amalekites, but he did not destroy the war spoils of those people.
Right.
I want you to hear me tonight loud and clear.
Oh.
Partial obedience is disobedience. Tried to justify his disobedience when the prophet came around. And he said it was the people that saved the enemy's cattle so that we would have animals to sacrifice on God's altar.
Yeah.
In other words, the reason we did it was to worship God. In other words, he tried to disguise his disobedience through his worship. Have you ever seen that happen? Listen to me, you can run a mile. You can jump high and hit your head on the ceiling. And you can shout loud to the Lord. You can speak in tongues like a Chinaman. But if you are living in disobedience, God will not honor your worship. cannot compensate for your disobedience.
Wow.
Your obedience, God said, is more important to me than your worship is. The Lord has great delight in the burnt offerings and the sacrifices as in obeying the voice of the Lord. That was the question the prophet asked. Amen. And the Lord wants us to know it's important to just simply do what He says.
Amen.
I've got another one too. Is it okay? Priority number five is to live clean and pure before the Lord.
Yes.
Thanks to modern media and a lot of other close communication things, it's very easy to not live clean and pure. Have impure thoughts.
Right.
Psalms 24, verse 3 and 4 asks the question, who shall ascend to the hill of the Lord? Who shall stand in His holy place? In other words, who's going to heaven? Who's going to the holy place of God? And then the answer is, he that hath clean hands and a pure heart. Understand the part about having a pure heart, because we guard our heart from evil thoughts and what have you. But what about the part of having clean hands? Does that mean we go around with some liquid soap to wash our hands every now and then so we have clean hands? No. It's very difficult to sin without involving your hands. Think about that now. Sin starts on the inside, but the execution of sin, in one way or another, usually involves your hands. We stop the uncleanness inside of our mind so that we won't get our hands dirty. Be careful what you read. Be careful what you watch. Be careful what you listen to. Keep you out of sin, but it will put you into heaven. Thank God for that hope. Priority number six, and listen carefully, is to let nothing steal your faith. There's a lot of gimmicks that the devil has to steal your faith. I'm not going into all of that. But when writing to Timothy, the Apostle Paul referred to some people who did not hold on to their faith. And as a result, they made shipwreck of their lives. And if we lose our faith, we've lost everything.
Amen.
Faith is so important. Without faith, it's impossible to please God. We are saved by faith. We are healed by faith. And we walk by faith and not by sight. And Satan knows that. And he knows how important it is for us to keep the faith. And that he attacks us with questions and doubts. And I tell you what, it's time to feed your faith.
Yes.
So you can starve your fears.
Yes.
Amen. Because Jesus said, with men it's impossible, but not with God. For with God all things are possible. Faith cometh by hearing, hearing by the word of God. In this house tonight. Will the Son of Man find faith in the earth when He comes? Let's answer that question tonight. Will He? Final priority tonight is priority seven. That's simply this. Finish what God has called you to do.
Yes.
The Apostle Paul referred to this in Acts chapter 20. He was talking about going into Jerusalem, not knowing the things that would befall him there. And he knew that there would be bonds and afflictions that would come his way. But he said, none of these things move me, and neither count I my life dear to myself, so that I might finish my course with joy at the ministry which I received of the Lord Jesus to testify the gospel of the grace of God. Paul purposed in his heart to be a finisher and to finish strong. That's what we need to do.
Yes.
A work has begun in this church.
Yes.
Can we purpose along with Paul that we're going to be a finisher of what God has started?
Yes.
Amen. It's real common with some people when they're young and energetic and zealous in the work of the Lord. They get involved and give it everything they've got. Really, really get into it for a while, but gradually lose that interest and lose that first love.
Right.
When they do, they fulfill the prophecy that in the last days, the love of many would wax cold. I don't know how you feel tonight. I know how I feel, and I want to finish the work that God's begun in me. And like Paul's commentary on this subject, he said, I know whom I believe, and I'm persuaded that he's able to keep that which I've committed unto him against that day.
Amen.
Can anybody join with me tonight with a strong persuasion, amen, that God is going to finish in us the work that he began? First started. I don't really know the year that it started, but something was started over here in Oil City. Amen. And I'm going to tell you, my prayer for you tonight is the prayer that Paul prayed for the Philippian church. And that is, I thank God every time I remember you. Always in every prayer of mine, for you all, making requests with joy for your fellowship in the gospel from the first day till now, being confident of this very thing, that he which hath begun a good work in you will perform it until the day of Jesus Christ. There may be people here tonight that were here when this church first started. That was way back there. Let me tell you something. There is never going to come a time when this work folds up.
Amen.
He has begun a good work in you, will perform it to the day of Jesus Christ. We're in troublesome times, folks, and we need to get some priorities straight.
That's right.
We need to love God with all our hearts. Please God in every way. Obey God. Keep the faith and finally finish the course. God bless you. Congratulations.
Can we all stand and thank you for the husband who tremendous word of God? And Pastor Campbell is coming. Pastor Campbell is coming to this pulpit, no stranger to this pulpit or to this local assembly. And we thank for his dedication, what he give to the kingdom of God, especially here in Old City. Amen. For believing in our pastor. Amen. Thankful for that. Amen. Brother Trammell, look behind him. There's a ministry team of All City. Amen. The legacy lives on.
Thank you, Brother Warren. Tell you what, y'all gonna have to slow down a little bit. These folks here at All City know that I'm nearly 84 years old. But I want to finish the course. I yes. told Brother Hutchbuck he should have just finished it up here tonight. It's an honor to be at All City and to feel what we feel present here tonight. Great Spirit of God. Praise God.
Yes, Lord.
I'd like to just join right in and give you what I have. All week long, I've been dealing with the book of Jonah. And I don't know if that's going to fit here or not, but really what I'd like to do is talk about the great God of the book of Jonah. You know, there's more miracles, probably more miracles in the book of Jonah than most any short book. God is a great, great God. Praise God. I was going to read from the book of Jonah, but most of you know the story. So we're going to try to just join in what's going on and preach a little while about the goodness and the greatness of God. Praise God. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, we come to you. I'm asking for your touch, your anointing, your help. Oh Lord, we ask for anointing of the Holy Ghost, that your Spirit touch us tonight. And we'll thank you for it. We'll thank you for it. In Jesus' name, in Jesus' name, in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Congratulations. You may be seated. Congratulations to Brother Sister Rose. 10 years. Great job. Praise God. 10 years. All of your children have grown up, married, except for Joy. Where's Joy? Joy. Joy is 17. And I saw a bumper sticker the other day, Joy. Not all women are fools. Some are single. So, hang in there. Isn't God good? It's all right to laugh in the house of the Lord. Almost seems like a coincidence. I asked when I saw all these pastors and ministers here, what am I doing? And then it dawned on me, I pastored this church. That's what I'm doing. Some of the greatest years of my life right here in All City. I feel like this was the crowning place of my life. It seemed like almost a coincidence that we came here, but I know there's no coincidence with God. There is providence, and we came here about providence.
It
was the right time and the right place. And God gave us a great revival, and blessing of the Lord was with us for about 4 years. And as I've said, I've been dealing with the book of Jonah, and you know the story of Jonah. If you're here tonight and you are away from God, God's got your number. He knows where you are. And he knows how to catch up with you. He knows exactly what to do to bring you to God. back to get into touch with God. You know, I like these short books that tell the whole story. The beginning and the end and the in-between in about 20 minutes. Reason for that, that's my probably my span that I can hold a thought at about 20 minutes. And I tell you what, I've learned some things in 80 years that most people, like a preacher, that can get to the end, the beginning, and the middle in about 20 minutes. So by the help of the Lord, we'll do that. In fact, looking back through the Word of God after having looked at the book of Jonah, I got to look at the short books in the Bible. One of them is Ruth, and it was put between the law and some of the long books in the Bible. It's a beautiful story. Beautiful story of Ruth. Although it's kind of a sad story because it was a story of backsliding. Praise God. If you're here tonight and you're backslidden, you need to find your way back to the altar. Because every backslider is going to get back. Four went out and only one came back. Only one got back to the house of bread. And so if you're here tonight and God's pulling on you and dealing with your heart, this would be a good night to make your way to the altar and to pray through and say, God, touch his life. And feel the Holy Ghost move in your life. Praise God. In fact, Ruth herself was witnessed to by a backslider. How come Ruth in the Bible at all? Because a backslider witnessed to her and talked to her about a house of bread. Talked to her about what was going on in Israel. And you know the story of Ruth and Naomi, how she came back. I like to think of Ruth as a person who just gives her life completely to God. I like to see folks just come in the church and just say, here's my life. Fill in the blanks. Do what you want to do. Use me where you want to use me. Praise God. I believe that ever saint of God ought to just say, Lord, here's my life. You just go ahead and fill in the blanks. A beautiful picture coming back to the house of bread. If you read the last few verses of the book of Ruth, it's beautiful. Praise God. The lineage of Jesus is right there. Stops with David, which is the son of Jesse, which is the son of David, which is, and he leaves it there, and we know who the son of David is. We know it. Tonight, and I'm just glad that I met the son of David one time. Praise God. And I feel that presence here tonight. Then we go about seven or eight more books, and there's the book of Esther. Esther was a lady that gave her life to the church. In fact, she said, if I'm going to the king, and if I perish, I perish. Yeah. Ruth gave her life to God. Esther gave her life for the church. She said, I'm going to the king, and if I perish, I perish. Yes. Praise God. You ought to just make up your mind tonight that I'm going to the church, and if I perish, I perish. I want God to touch my life. I want God to do something in my life. And I'm asking God just to look down here tonight. And I'm asking the Lord for that powerful move of the Holy Ghost that I feel like it's just brewing down deep. Praise God. I feel the presence of the Lord here. Thank the Lord for the presence of the Lord. When I read the book of Jonah, I saw more than just a backslidden prophet. I saw more than just a disobedient prophet. Every Sunday school child could tell you something about Jonah. But I saw a God that's able to speak to the wind. A God that's able to calm the storm. And if you've got a storm in your life tonight, I believe that we're serving a God that can calm that storm. Praise the name of the Lord. I'm just glad that I learned that it is He that we need to calm the storm. I believe every problem can be solved in the presence of Almighty God. Praise God. If you have a problem, bring it to the house of the Lord. Ask the Lord, would you just help me tonight to find an answer to the problems that I have? problem. Not only did he speak to the storm, in fact, I've been on the ocean in a storm, and I remember looking out of that ship, and I could see waves as far as I could see. It looked like mountains. We looked like a mansion on the ocean. And I thought, how great our God is to just speak to the wind. And the wind not only would cease, but the storm, the water would stop raging. I thank God that I know a God that can calm the storms of your life. He can calm the storms of your life. He can speak to the storm, and everything has to lay down and be quiet. In fact, I saw a God that can even deal with the lot. They cast lots to see who's bringing the problem, and the lot fell on Jonah.
Yes.
Wouldn't you know that that just might not happen, but God caused the lot to fall on. You know, we use lots, brother. We elect presbyters and pastors and things of that. And God is able to direct your life through just things that you really don't think about.
Yeah.
Right. God is able to direct your heart tonight. If you just turn it to him,
amen.
He can speak to the marine life. In fact, he spoke to a whale, and he said, go get him. It was right at the time that they were about to throw Jonah overboard. God spoke to the whale. In fact, and the whale obeyed. Yes, he did. But he's better than the prophet. Praise God. God can speak to the animal life. God can speak to the marine life. God knows exactly where you are tonight, and he's able to speak to that disobedience and give you a second chance. You know, God spoke to Jonah the second time, and he spoke to the whale the second time. And he said, "Take him over there and vomit him out on the dry land." And few really understand the greatness of God. You understand how great God is in the book of Jonah. Just the little things that he did. He is right here tonight. He is in this place tonight to touch your life. Praise the name of the Lord. There may be somebody here that's disobedient to God. There may be somebody here that you're trying to get away from the call of God. And I'm not trying to call anybody to preach. You better know if you're called to preach. Praise God. I worked with Brother Barnes for 11 years, and we have these young men come along, and they want Brother Barnes. Man, praise God. I said, what they need to do is get his problems. Praise God. If you're gonna ask for his mantle, you're gonna get his problems. I told the pastor there the other night, I said, it's not hard to know who got his mantle. I said, you got his problems too. If you're asking for a mantle, if you're asking to be called to preach, you better stay around the pastor a little while and see what he goes through. You better walk with him through the hard places of his life. I remember, brother. I was thinking about this today, Brother Hutchman. I remember many years ago, Brother Barnes was going through a terrible place, a place that not many of us would want to go through. And he had a revival announced in the city building. And the evangelist come and broke down or something. And you preached that night. You remember that? Praise God. All you preach. In an evangelist place. Brother Barnes walking through a place that you'd never know. So what I'm saying tonight, if you really want the hand of God on your life, get ready to go through the problems. Get ready to live for him no matter what comes your way. No matter what life offers, just make up your mind. In fact, if you knew what many of these great men go through, I don't think you'd want to go through. In fact, James and John asked one time, if they could sit on the right hand and on the left hand in glory. And Jesus said, can you drink the cup that I... They said, yes, we can. But after they saw him drink the cup, I'm not for sure they wanted to drink the cup. Praise God. When we really understand what we've got to go through to preach the gospel and to really live for the Lord, no matter what it takes. You got to preach when you're up, and you got to preach when you're down. You got to preach when somebody comes, and you got to preach if nobody shows.
Right.
So Praise God. You have to make up your mind, no matter what, I'm going to live for the Lord.
Yes,
sir. God is a powerful God. He can speak to the elements. He can speak to the sea. He can speak to the real life. He's God of providence. Providence. I made mention coming here to just a providence. I know 1 year before we left Minden, I tried to resign, and Brother Barnes just would not let us go. And I said, all right, Brother Barnes, I'll stay until you can get a man that's between us. We're getting both of us too old to pastor. He is older than I am now. So I stayed with him till Brother Rhymes came. And would you know, just a month later, and that's when our city needed the pastor.
Yeah.
Providence. God knows where you are. God knows exactly how to get you there. And I thank the Lord. I know a God that knows everything. He knows exactly where you are tonight. He knows the problems you have. If you just really be willing to bring it to Him and say, I need Jesus. If you're here tonight and you don't have the Holy Ghost, tonight would be a good night. Try and have a good time. Just ask the Lord. If you're here and you're asking in heart, you know what Naomi said? Naomi said, I left full and I came empty, came back. You know what backsliding brings? Emptiness in your spirit and emptiness in your soul. And if you're here tonight and you're empty on the inside, this would be a good time to ask God, just fill up that empty place. Fill up that empty place. I'm hungry. I'm hungry for the Holy Ghost. When you're out of the will of the Lord, nothing works right. God knows exactly where you are. In fact, I talk about providence. You know, sometimes God uses providence instead of just telling you how to get there. He told his disciples, he said, go into the city, and the man that you see that has a pitcher of water, follow him. You know, he just as easily had told him what address. He could give him the house number and where to go. He said, that man that's got a pitcher of water, you follow him. Praise God. Praise God. God knows. And in another place, he said, there's a donkey tied to a certain place. And he said, go get it. And if anybody asks you why you're doing this, just tell them the Lord needs it. And they'll let it go. You know, God knows exactly where we are. God knows what you're in need of tonight. I wonder if you here tonight and you need something from the Lord, you just ask the Lord, this is my night. This is my time to receive that touch from the Lord. In fact, God is so great. He can speak to the fish. He can speak to the city. He can speak to a gourd vine. Yes, and He can speak to a cutworm. Amen. Isn't that a great God? Think about it. God is the God of the elements. God knows everything. Everything about it. He knows where you are. And He knows exactly what you need tonight. Not so long ago, I was in desperate need of the touch from the Lord. I was asking God, Lord, I just need to know. I need an anchor. I need to anchor. You know, when you get old and sometimes you just need to know where you are. Praise God. I remember working with Brother Barnes, and once in a while somebody would call him and say, Brother Barnes, God told me to tell you that He loved you. And I thought, well, you know, that's not a great revelation. But it meant something to him. Sometimes we get old and we need God. And I fasted 3 days and nothing particularly happened. Next morning, I was felt like I was just in the presence of the Lord. Just in the presence of the Lord. Just everything was right. My wife said, what do you want for breakfast? I said, don't think I'm going to eat today. I'm going to fast another day just to give thanks to the Lord. Just to give thanks. Praise God. hold and grips the solid rock. That rock is Jesus. And I'm thankful tonight. I'm thankful tonight. I came out saying, who's singing here? Come in and help me somebody. Praise God. Let's sing one of Dr. Rambo's old song. You know, if this isn't love, then the ocean is dry. The sparrow can't fly. Let's just stand. And in the presence of the Lord, I think we ought to just close the service tonight, worshiping the Lord. If this isn't love, then the ocean is dry. The sparrow can't fly. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. And I really felt like I got a hold of something that I could say my anger holds and grips the solid rock. Thank you for it, Lord Jesus. Thank you for it, Lord. Go ahead. Let's sing something, Brother Wayne. Go ahead, Brother Wayne. Praise God. Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, and Jesus. I wonder, I don't know how I'm supposed to close this. Somebody tell me. I say, I don't know how I'm supposed to close this. You want me to just have an altar call, or what do you want to do? Let's just come toward the front, what do you say? And worship the Lord. As we close this service tonight, I feel the presence of the Lord here. There may be somebody here, you need the Holy Ghost. You need God to reach down and touch your life. You need the Spirit of the Lord in your life.